I just wanted to make sure that you're happy to see me. Hey, usually in the classroom, I speak science, things that have been proved by experiments. And sometimes things have been proved by animal experiments, followed by human experiments, and so on. But certainly not today. I am fully aware that I am talking about a subject in which I have no particular qualification. I do have one qualification. That is, I have had the experience of numerous people sharing their lives with me. This is an experience that you also will have. You also, as you go into people's lives, you have the enormous privilege of people sharing their lives with you. And that teaches us a lot. I see that Vandana Mahajan is in the group. I'm sure numerous people would have shared your lives with you, Vandana. And I'm sure a lot of people here in this group have had much more experience in what I'm going to talk about than me. Especially those who are counselors and psychologists. There would also be some people who haven't had that privilege. I naturally will have to go at the level of the new entrant to the field. And then I'll share with all of you some things that people have taught me. A little bit that I have learned from books or journals, but more from the human textbooks that have been revealed to me. Can we? I'm going to ask you to share a bit of yourself with me today. In here. I'll start with a poll. Are we ready to put the poll on? Are we?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. There is a question coming up to you. There must be some people here whose answers may not fit into the poll. There must be others who came into this for a different reason. To those people, so here we have 55 people who do this because they get satisfaction from helping others, and 45% of people because they want to learn more about palliative care, for whatever reason that is. So, I am stopping the poll there and asking you, are there several people who are here for a different reason? Either unmute and speak or put it upon the chat box. No chats yet.
Good afternoon, doctor.
Hi.
Yeah.
Sorry, who are you? Parul.
Parul Negi from Dipshika NGO. Yeah.
From where?
Dipshika Trust for Cancer Care.
Where?
Head office is at Guwahati, Assam. And you? Here I am in Mumbai.
Okay.
We have our Arogya Bhavans in Mumbai also, sir.
Yeah. Pleased to meet you, Parul.
Yeah. Very much looking forward to this session, sir, to share whatever knowledge you have with us. And here, because we have our hospice at Sontala Mirza in Assam. So whenever I visit the hospice there, I definitely thought that this course will be helpful and teach me to interact with those patients in a much better way. Besides the satisfaction of dealing with many cancer patients here in Mumbai also. That's the
Parul, yes. You want to help dying people more. Or you want to help people who are seriously ill more, right?
Yes.
Why, Parul?
Yeah.
What will it get you? Why do you want to do that? I mean, even if you do not study more, even if you are just going and looking after whatever you have been doing in the past, you still get the, if you are drawing a salary, you get the same salary. So by being empowering yourself to help those people more, what's in it for you?
I can say it's worth $1 billion. The satisfaction which you get is not anything compared to the corporate job which I had. I was in a pharma industry earlier, but I left that. And after that, I'm into leprosy as well as cancer patients. With my background being cancer research from Tata Hospital. But what I have seen over these years, nearly more than 15 to 18 years I've been in this field. And at the end of the day, the satisfaction it brings is very difficult to translate into words.
Parul.
Yes.
Would it be correct if I paraphrase what you're saying and say that the work that you do with people in the hospice makes your life more meaningful?
Exactly. Very much so.
Parul, thank you. You have already done half the class, spirituality. Thank you. Hey, Ajita. Ajita, is this my friend? Ajita from Trivandrum. Ajita,
yes, sir.
You want to make yourself visible for a moment?
Yeah, I am visible now.
Ajita, let me reflect. Hi, I didn't know that you were in the group, and it is such a pleasant surprise. Ajita, let me now deflect that question back to you. You said you want to be a part of the palliative care team when you get back to India. Why, Ajita?
Pardon?
Why? See, listen, you are in Abu Dhabi. You are in Abu Dhabi.
I know.
Certainly not going to make more money by coming and working in palliative care.
No. I don't want to make money. I already made enough for myself, I think so.
So why?
See, there was a period in my life when I felt that people were coming out of the way to help me. So I think I owe it to the society to do something for those who need us, not for the money aspect.
You have you feel that some people were kind to you.
Many so you, of them. You, by God's grace, everything I survived.
Friends, we don't want to go into the details, but Ajita, certainly not. Not of course not. But you have gone through a tough life. And there are several reactions that could come out of it. But you are reacting to it is not to look at the negatives, but to look at what was given to you, positive things that came to you, and say, I want to give it back to the society.
Yeah, true.
Thank you. That is spirituality for you. Parul and Ajita, you have made my job easy by sharing your perspective. Thank you very much. I'm going to share my screen now with your permission. You have your body, your person. Your person is your body and mind together, I agree. You have your family. You have your possessions. The money that Ajita was talking about. The money, the house that you... that you were dreaming about that house for many years and you finally built it, or you are going to build it, your car. All those possessions are part of your life. The body is not to be ignored, because unless you have reasonable comfort, gradually you lose interest in everything else. Today, my colleague Amrita, whom some of you know, is struggling with a patient's pain. A pain that was overwhelming, not only that to the person, to the whole team. The whole team is suffering today, or the last few days, with that person, with a difficult pain. When pain is all encompassing like that, you have no time for anything else. But at least when you have a reasonable degree of comfort, apart from your family and possessions, some things also are important to you. I am not giving you any official definition of palliative care. Actually, a few years back, I was looking for a definition, and I looked up quite a bit of literature. There were some things peculiar. On the whole, I found 27 different definitions of palliative care. All the 27 were very long and had many five-syllable words. All of a sudden, you are talking about existential and words that you do not use in conversation. I was looking for something simple, that's something that I could connect with. I'm not such an erudite person as to understand even most of those words. And to me, whatever are not your immediate material needs, including your own body and comfort, your immediate family and your possessions, many other things are important as it happens. And those form the spiritual makeup of a person. And here we have a more spiritual group than elsewhere, because for most of you, many things apart from your possessions or immediate your family are more important. And this part, the spiritual makeup that is not easily visible, that cannot be shown on an MRI scan, is what we are going to talk about. We'll talk about what we feel are three important components of the spiritual makeup of a person. And then later, we will talk about how we can use that bit of knowledge to help human beings. How Parul will be able to get people in the hospice in Guwahati better, and how Ajita is going to support people around her and back home when she comes back. Those are the things that we talk about. Just three points that I'm going to talk about. One is values and belief systems. Two is the meaning and purpose of life. And three are the connections. These are the three things we'll go into some detail with, some possibly aided by some stories. Your own belief systems can be very different. The majority of human beings in our country are very religious. most of spirituality for the majority of you is connected to the concept of God or religion, but not for everybody. I have known some atheists, people who both, I mean, very forcibly say, I don't believe in God, but I have considered them some of the most spiritual people in this world. Not everybody, not every agnostic is spiritual, I wouldn't say that, but I have known more people who are spiritual among atheists than otherwise. About the values and beliefs, who is going to help me? Parul and Ajita have spoken already. Somebody else. Who is the next person? I'm sorry, I can't. Mr. Keshav Sharma? Are you able to see the screen? Are you able to unmute and speak?
Yes, I can see the screen, sir.
Will you please read it out? Read out this passage from Chochinov. Harvey Chochinov, by the way, most of you, many of you would know him. He is the founder of the concept of dignity therapy, working so much on dignity. And I see Vandana nodding vigorously. And he is a guru for the whole world. And Chochinov wrote this. So you are going to read it out for us?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Values and belief. Treating a patient's severe arthritis and not knowing their core identity as a musician. Providing care to a woman with a metastatic breast cancer and not knowing she is a sole carer for the two young children. Attempting to support a dying patient and not knowing he or she is devoutly religious. Each of these scenarios is equivalent to attempting to operate in the dark.
Would you place a knife on somebody's body? Would a surgeon place a knife on somebody's body without seeing the body? So this is what Chochinov says. What is the lesson there? If we are to treat the body, our MRI scans and physical examination will be enough. But if we are to treat the person, we need to get to know the person. How are we going to get to know the person? Oh, okay, that also we'll talk about. But this, I think, is a very important message in spiritual care that I want to bring up in the beginning. Without getting to know the person, in the vast majority of situations, you cannot give spiritual care. I know there will be a lot of people who ask for a priest in the last moment. I have a palliative care physician friend. She told me about, she had a spiritual guru, but certainly she was not close to him or anything. And when, as a young woman, she had a deadly disease. And at the height of the illness, she asked to see that guru. On that day, the guru was supposed to meet the Prime Minister. He had an appointment. The guru cancelled the appointment with the Prime Minister of India and went to see her. She talks about that as a turning point in her life and how she could cope with her illness and still continue to work as a palliative care physician. This is spiritual care for a lot of people. You get to ask to see a guru. You ask for a priest and the priest comes and you say, please pray for me. That also is valuable. I am not negating that. But for the vast majority, any spiritual care means getting to know the person. Any comments, anybody? Apart from, I mean, we'll talk more about this later. Apart from the value and the another important part of one's spiritual makeup is the meaning and purpose of life. What is meaningful for you? I'll stop sharing for the screen for a minute. But have you met this person? She is supposed to come and do one session for you. Has she done that already?
Yes. Yes, sir. That's yes, already done. Yes.
Okay.
Ashla Ram.
I look at the smile on her face. Oh my God. Ashla was giving a talk in the city of Cochin, maybe a few years back. She was addressing a group of about 1,400 people, just for 5 minutes. She said, as you already know, she's quadriplegic, cannot even use her fingers or types of her knuckles. And at that talk, she said, she concluded like this. Prior to that, she had been with us in palliative care for 4 years. She said, I had full control over my body for 28 years. Then I had my accident and became paralyzed. If you give me a choice, I would want to walk again. But it's equally true that my life in the last 4 years have been more meaningful than my life when fully functional for 28 years. What, despite the physical disability that she got, what makes the difference for her is her life is meaningful. There's a purpose to it. For most people, the purpose is something that keeps moving away. You are an assistant professor, you're looking forward to your promotion as associate professor. I know because I went through that. Oh, you were so eager for that promotion, associate professor. And then it comes, its value gets lost. For a few years, you are very happy. For a few days, you are very happy. Then you are looking at something else. It keeps shifting. Now, I bring this up here because when we care for someone, while we set that in the first values, we have to get to know the person. Why? So that we will find out what is important for the person. Let me stop the screen share for a minute. I will go on and then I'll stop and talk about the incidents. So how do you do these things? How do you get to know the person? How do you find out what is meaningful for them? Here are a few things that one could do. Tell me about yourself. People will be taken aback if you say that. I don't know how you will respond if all of a sudden I ask you to tell me about yourself. Oh, sorry. You may respond, wait a minute. Rajini, a few minutes back, you had put up in the chat box, is it just that or more than that? Can you tell us what connection that came up? I'm sorry that I did not see that chat immediately.
Basically, I said that when you were saying that it's just a value system. So it's just when you were talking about that, but then you went on to define the other things as well. You know, like that wholesome treatment. No? So I got my answer. So that's why I did not appreciate
that. Okay, thank you.
I totally agree with like everything, right? It's just the definition of the health asset as we know that, right? Both physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual. And in that, that spiritual, I feel, involves all these components, and which you definitely highlighted. So,
thank you very much. In fact, this is interesting. The World Health Organization's definition of health does not include spiritual, physical, mental, and social well-being. People are afraid of the word. I mean, unless you can measure it, people are scared of phrases like this. And spiritual gets too much associated with religion. And then all the negatives also come in. If I totally agree with you, WHO came to me just now and said, hey, Rajagopal, give us a better definition of healthcare. Okay, I'll talk to all of you and we'll certainly add that. So we were still at that meaning of life and the few questions. Tell me about yourself. Every one of you must have numerous, or most of you would have numerous experiences, especially in this group, of incidents like that. I remember a very unhappy man in our inpatient unit. He was unhappy because his story was he was a manual laborer. Well, he worked in a rubber plantation. He was the caretaker for the owner. He had a small hut in a corner. There he lived with his wife and children. Children were growing up now. The man would leave early in the morning. Then his wife will have to take his breakfast to him, or one of his children will take his breakfast to him. He will come for lunch, have a nap, and then he would go again. He would come back by sunset, have a bath, spend some time with the family. And when the children were settling down with their studies, he would get a torch and go back. Just for a round to see the fence is not broken, no animals have broken in. That was his life. And now he had cancer. He was not very old, maybe around 50. His wife went on saying, you spent your whole life like that. And what did you get? I know what he got. When he was admitted to the cancer hospital, the owner of the estate and his wife visited him, gave him 500 rupees and told him that they have engaged somebody else in his role. 500 rupees. And she was saying, you gave 500 rupees for your whole life. You gave your life, whole life for those 500 rupees plus your meager wages. We are living in this hut. What have we got? The man would be silent and he was the picture of sadness. This happened after we had relieved his pain. So we did the usual. We asked him, tell me about your life. And he described his life. He had grown up as an orphan, brought up by his brother. His sister-in-law was not very kind to him. So as an adolescent, he left home. And this life, this hut, this family were things that he built himself. And in his own personal code of conduct, a healthy person had no reason to be idle. He said, I have this health so that I could use it. Work was his worship. And then he sadly added, I know that did not bring me a lot of riches, And I'm sorry that my family feels my life is wasted. The one thing that I told him is how much of respect I had for him. I said, I will consider him a guru, teaching the message of work as worship. I told the children that I truly believe that you have reason to be proud of your dad. He is an exceptional person. I didn't say anything that I did not fully believe. All that I did to look back on it a bit clinically was to listen to his story, pick out the most positive, and reinforce it back to him and his family. Everybody cried, the children cried, the wife cried. And later, without nobody asking her, the wife said, he's a good man. I believe our team's conversation with that person was truly spiritual care. I believe that is part of the heart of spiritual care. Listening to a story and acknowledging the positive. Arising from that, I have something to ask you, each one of you. You all have a loved one at home, whom you do not see frequently. Maybe a grandparent, maybe an uncle or an aunt who was very close to you in your childhood. You know that happens, don't you? Uncles or aunts look after you and you are great friends. But as you grow, you become adolescents. You have less time for all that. And we go our separate ways. And if there is somebody like that, how frequently do you give them a call? Let me ask you. And let me ask you, how much do you know about them? They know about you from your childhood. Do you really know them? They have been giving you. You have been taking, just as I took. I took a lot of it. I took a lot from a lot of people. I don't think I gave back anything much. I don't want you to make that mistake. Someday, find a chance to visit that person and sit down and say, tell me the story of your life. Auntie, tell me the story of your life. I'm sure she would look surprised. Hey, has this girl gone crazy? What is this man saying? And then he said, tell me about your childhood. I just don't know you. I want to know you more. They'll be pleased. They will share the stories. And I'm sure you will learn a lot from those stories. What I'm saying is, we talk about palliative care and often forget that this very often has to start at home. This is about life. This is about our meaning of life. This is about our loved ones' meanings of life. Comments, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon, Dr. Raj.
Hi, Vandana.
I think a lot of us, at least I would say that I don't know many of my loved ones. I don't know the story of their lives. So I think I will start from home, though I interact with a lot of patients and I know more about them than I would know the story of the lives of my loved ones. So yes, that's, I will start doing that. And also, Dr. Raj, I think spirituality for me is to be able to connect to the patients at a human level. to feel for them and just see them as another human being, as much as I am a human being. That is what I wanted to say.
Vandana, thank you. Thank you very much, Vandana. We will want to come back to that later on this afternoon.
Sure, sir.
Prasanna has sent a chat message saying that I've had several such experiences from school friends than my grand-aunt and her husband. And Rajanish Kumar says, I really have not tried to try something. No, the people who helped me grow, I would like to change that before it is too late. Before it is too late. Thank you, Rajanish Kumar. You would be doing something that I failed to do when I had the chance. And now I live with some regret about some things. If there are no other comments. Prasanna also says, as a child, I found myself different in the way I felt their pain. From Prasanna, you want to speak a little bit about that? Or are you saying that as a child, you did better than you are doing now?
No, I said, first, good afternoon, sir. Even at an age of 13, I felt myself different from my friends in a way, like when a friend had lost their father, it was like I could feel the pain. I needn't lose my father for me to lose that pain, but I could feel that pain. And I found that very different. Because when somebody had lost a father, the other friends wouldn't approach and go and talk to them. Whereas something within me will keep pushing me in. I'll be like a shadow behind this person always. If she turns back, there's someone for her and she could talk. And I'll make myself visible wherever that person is. At some point, no, they'll have to bump into me like a wall and they open up to me. So this was the difference that I found. And I think my landing point is Pallium India. So what I searched when I was 13 years as a child, I got my answer when I was 48. Because my mom diverted me into dentistry. And again, my search didn't complete. Because it was only the dental pain that I was alleviating. Even at that point, I would ask, the moment a patient sits in a dental chair, they have their palpitations. So I would never treat them immediately. I would see as to how they respond sitting in the chair. So the first would be only talking, conversing, and only a consultation. And I'll say that the treatment would be when they want it. So never saying it has to be done now. It's something as important as this. Otherwise, it will go into something else. I'll never put a fear. That's what I meant. So they're already coming in with the pain. I attend only to that pain. And then when they're comfortable and confident, be it a child or elderly people. So those two are the age group I love. And Pallium India has them. So I would love to be with you, Dr. Raj.
Prasanna, thank you. Thank you very much. You give more meaning to my life now.
We have a few more comments in the chat box. Are we reading it now or
one second, let me respond to this particular comment by Prasanna. I earlier showed this image. People are different. For some, these circles are much larger, leaving very little space outside them. That's okay. That's the way they are. And we, you and I, learn to accept people as they are, without being judgmental, without looking down on them. Whereas Prasanna, right from the beginning compared to most others, had more of this area, the spiritual area. The people whose lives are filled with the three smaller circles all the time. Once you get the Audi, you want a Mercedes also in the garage. That kind of possessions and ambitions, etc., sometimes find themselves in serious trouble towards the end. They find that their money cannot buy another life. Everything that was meaningful to them till that point is lost, and they are totally lost. What am I saying? This world has a lot of people like Prasanna, whose spirituality is a prominent part of their lives, but also people who do not have that so much. And we will remember that maybe those people who are more materialistic in their lives need us more. Prasanna may be better able to handle herself, whereas those people will have nothing left, and they are the ones who are just flailing about and in great agitation, and sitting down with them and talking. And then what that we'll come to now. After we have listened to them, they may justify themselves, their lives, and that may be what they want to do. But then what do we do about that after getting to know the person? And this, I have given the link there in the bottom. This is Dr. Christopher Booth, a friend of India, an oncologist in Kingston, Canada, who until the COVID times would visit India at least twice every year, spend his money and help a lot of people. So when he went out home, he says, in this article, he has written this article, it's free access. Any of you can access the article and read. In this article, he says, he asked the man in the house, in a humble home in Trivandrum, what does that, he had it translated, what does the visit by the home care team mean to you? And the patient said, first of all, I feel very loved. Sorry for bragging. I always boast a lot about our team, the wonderful people that I work with. So I don't know what magic they did, but the first response of the man to Chris was not about the pain being relieved, not about the financial support that came for his children's education, but first of all, I feel very loved. We talked about values and beliefs. We talked about meaning and purpose of life. We talked about connections. We haven't yet talked about connections. We will come back to that. But for everything, I think this is a first step in management of a person. Do them love. There is no chapter on love in your textbook. Certainly not in any of the medical textbooks that I have seen. And that is not easily measurable. So maybe science doesn't like that. But that, I feel, is the essence of spiritual care. Even that person, the person who was very materialistic, who never cared much for others, maybe he was even cruel to others in his quest for more possessions. I would remember not to be judgmental to him. I would recognize him to be one in intense suffering. And he deserves me or my attention more than somebody who is spiritually far above me. So that is the beginning of spiritual care as far as I am concerned. Truly caring for them and conveying that, not hiding it. Which brings me to the connections now. Before your course is over, I hope everyone will write an advance directive. The medical system, doctors and nurses do not really realize the enormity of the spiritual agony that we create by incarcerating people in intensive care units. We may have touched upon it briefly during our introduction to palliative care. I was an intensivist. I'm an anesthetist by training. I was an intensivist. I know that intensive care unit can save lives by minute-to-minute monitoring of every organ function. If the heart fails and if you do not treat it instantaneously, other organs also will get killed. That's frightfully important. But that's when in a salvageable situation. When the condition is not salvageable, when somebody is clearly dying, when treatment is clearly futile, continuing to keep him there is an insult to humanity. It is outrage on the person. It is assault and battery on that person. Putting a tube in every orifice. And you see this. His hands and feet are tied to the bed so that he doesn't pull the tube out. The only difference between this and willful torture is this is not with the intention of inflicting injury. By the international definition, by the United Nations Rapporteur for Torture, this will not classify as torture because there is no intention to cause suffering. But this classifies as inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. Inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment is how they describe infliction of torture without the intention of torturing. That's what we do. It is not only the physical suffering, it is the disconnection. When my time comes, those months or days or hours, I will consider precious to rebuild connections that have been lost, to build some bridges if they have been broken, to tell a few people, I've always loved you, I care for you very much, to ask to see a person with whom I am estranged for several years, maybe a brother or a sister with whom one quarrels. Even this last week, we had this man who is seriously ill, who is dying. And his requirement was, after the story was told, he had quarreled with his son 8 years back. And our team members found the man, talked to him, made him come back, and made them make peace. These are the connections that need to be rebuilt. But here, we are not only allowing repair of broken bridges, we are not allowing making connections. We are actually destroying connection with everything. I hope we have enough time. I'll come back to the chat question in a minute. But now that I see that we have enough time, can I ask you to do an exercise? One, take a minute and think, what are the most important things for you in your life? You don't have to speak it out. It's a list that you make to yourself. If you have... Nobody does that ordinarily. You don't sit down at the end of the day and see what are the most important things for me. I am asking what are the most important things for you in your life. I'll keep quiet for a minute. Please think. If you care to, write it down on a pad or a pen or paper in front of you. Okay, no compulsion on anyone. Does anybody want to, I mean, not detailed descriptions, just make a list of those things? Does anybody want to? And share it with that group? Does anybody want to share? Many would be relationships.
Only one, Dr. Raj.
Mm.
I felt by saying this, it would define all my other things what I wanted to say.
Mm.
Try to see an ideal world.
Mm.
Make everything equal.
Mm.
That's it. If at all it's possible in my time, or if I can strive to do it in my own way, of my own connection, my own people. Make them understand an ideal world. That's all.
That's very profound. So, Prasanna, you want to be in an equitable, fair world, which you do not have at the moment. Now, look, suppose, Prasanna, I am just making use of your, I mean, I fold my hands to you. You are very, very, you have depth, no doubt. If it was somebody at the end of life on the bed, they may say, I was hoping that this world would be fair and just and equitable, but I see things keep getting worsening. I keep the divide between the rich and the poor widening. I see how rich countries keep exploiting the poor countries and keep making them poorer. I wish I didn't have to live with this. What was the point of me being alive? I'm just making use of Prasanna's statement to think of an exercise. If there was a man near the, or woman near the end of her life saying that, how do you deal with that? Not Prasanna, somebody else. I would say, you obviously are in great pain. Tell me about your life. Somebody was asking me, wait a minute. It was Rajani Shashumar who asked. I mean, like, so you cannot just go and say, tell me about your life. True. If I meet somebody and all of a sudden, hey, tell me about your life, he would be wondering which asylum has this man escaped from. True. You all know that any management starts with building a relationship. This is not coming out. You don't just go on rounds and say, hey, tell me about your life. You don't do that. You sit down there. You connect with I. You connect with I and... all of a sudden, I can't remember his name, the man who wrote the book from his deathbed. As he says, I want my physician to sit down with me for a minute. Connect with me as a person. That's all I ask. He goes on to say that he knows the doctor is busy. But he wants sitting down. He wants connect with thy. You do that. And if this man is in front of me or this woman is in front of me, I would feel it perfectly natural to say that you obviously are a very disappointed person. You want to tell me more about your life? And ordinarily, somebody who is coming out with that disappointment is full of conversation. If he is physically capable, they will tell the story. And that will be revealing. And then, to that person, who talks like Prasanna, I would say, so, in your case, you have done this, and this, and this, and this. I am recounting the positives. I am not recounting. He may have told me 7 mistakes that he did. I am not going to talk about it. But you did this. You served the people in the hospice, helped them. And your story would have included how somebody held your hand and cried for 7 minutes. And maybe somebody told you, I thought God had deserted me. I know he hasn't. He sent you to me. Your story would have included all that. And I would say, I truly believe that though you haven't found an equitable and fair and good world, you have already made the world a better place than it was. Those actions made the world a little bit better. If you quantify all the suffering, you chipped away some of that suffering, took it away. You have made the world a better place, even if you could not achieve their objective. That would be my way of dealing with that conversation. And I'm being honest. I shouldn't say anything that I don't feel, because if I don't feel it in here, my words will sound hollow. But I will point out how that person has made the world a little better place. To Rajini Sishumar, I'll repeat. It's about building a connection by conveying I care for you. And usually, this tell me the story of your life is not a first conversation. Almost everybody comes to us in great distress. And our first effort is to treat the physical suffering and find out the person more. And this conversation may happen, not when during a daily round, when everybody is looking at you and busy. But you find a quiet time, sit down with the person. There are several other comments, and I'll request the facilitator to pick out the most important ones. There were several about the how horrendous the intensive care is. Prasanna, if you heard my response to what you said, do you have a reaction?
Yes, I do, sir. I have done it in my own little way, but it started from my own life with that person. So as you said, I don't think I have the capacity to build or bring about the change what was beyond my control, or even his control or her control, but to attend to their minor and minute detailings, I was able to achieve 100%, but we made peace.
Thank you. Totally. I mean, I hope you also realize that you have made the world a little better place.
Definitely.
I hope each one of us will be able to acknowledge that and be thankful for that. That's a privilege, isn't it? Rajini Sishikumar finds another problem. Very often, it is too, I don't know if I have understood the statement properly. We cannot achieve all this, but before that, they slip into their pre-mortality condition. True. There are two elements of my response to that. One, whatever we are saying doesn't have to wait till somebody is dying. Certainly to your grandfather or grandmother, let us by all means start now. And even to patients, when there is an opportunity, it doesn't always happen. And they are not ready yet. But as early as possible is good. My second part of the answer is, I will do this if it is possible. It may not be possible. More often than not, it's not possible. And then I'll tell myself, Rajagopal, you are not God Almighty. You are only a human being. You have done your best. Now go to bed and sleep. I have to accept that. I have to accept my limitations also. And Prasanna has to accept it. If her desire for a fair and equitable world doesn't yet materialize in her lifetime, but if she is able to be satisfied with the knowledge that you have walked a few steps in the right direction, I think that will be a satisfying thought. Parul, in answer to the earlier question perhaps, says, we have to invest our time with the person so that they can talk freely. Yes, if you go first and ask them, before they know you, if you say, tell me about your life, they'll think you're crazy. They won't. Assure my availability in their need. Moushumi, absolutely. And that has to be realistic. I'll give the corollary. Never promise something that you cannot do. Because at this stage, you could well be the most important person for that patient. Nobody else has touched them deep in there, including their loved ones. Their relationships would have been rocky with all sorts of problems. A loved one may not be able to deal with the person as non-judgmentally as you or me. Therefore, we are at a special privilege. And that is very important. But if that person trusts you, they will be devastated if we break our promises. So I will not promise to be always available on the phone. I will not say I will come tomorrow unless I am reasonably certain that I will be able to come. Otherwise, I will come as soon as I can. I certainly want to meet you again. I will promise only what I can fulfill. With your permission, I am going back to my presentation for a little while longer. In the matter of rebuilding connections, I want to say one thing more. Of course, primarily, if you can get that person out, you will. One of these sessions we will have on end of life care, and we will see what is realistically possible. But as Prasanna said, we have that to move against. There is this huge injustice happening in India. This disease is more in India than in USA or UK. Incarceration and imprisonment in ICUs. And this has to change. We'll talk about that. If we can get the person out, we will. But leave that person alone. There are 47 people attending this. And many of you would find yourself in the same situation that I found myself in at one time. My parents had 4 children. We were all professionals or professionals of spouse and had to live elsewhere. None of us could be with my father when he was alone after my mother's death. He didn't want to leave his home. At the age of 93, he wanted to be there. And we all recognize the need for him to be there, to be amidst his plants and trees and everything around him. But on the last 3 days, we took him away. We said, this is no longer possible. Please come with us. So he chose, if I have to come, he chose one of us. He left and he came with me. And on his last day, he started seeing people who were dead, including his brother. And then he had his dinner and he said, early morning tomorrow, you must take me back home. And he lay down, and within half an hour, he was dead. I live with the guilt that I disconnected him from his world at a time when it was most precious for him. I am sharing that personal story. I was not very close to him, I will confess. I was not brought up as a child by him. But still I live with that guilt. And I am sharing that story so that you don't, if possible, make that mistake of taking younger parents away from where that person is connected. If possible, this is not an absolute rule. That may be the only possibility. That person may have to be taken away. I quite see that. Life is uncertain. But if possible, recognize the need for that person for the connection. Take him away to the 34th story apartment in Mumbai. Lock the person up. And when you go for work, tell the person, please do not open the door. If the door bell rings, it is not safe. And you go away. And the evening, you come get back home and find that the person has lost his or her mind. Connections are important. And this is something that we try to do. We have an inpatient facility. I don't like keeping people there. You have your hospice. That's inevitable. We have patients in the inpatient unit because they have no choice. They are physically unwell, or for some reason they need to be there. They have no place to go, so they need to be in the hospice. But keep the first people where they are connected. You know that you don't change the side of your bed with your spouse, do you? Do you take turns on the right and left side every day? Automatically you go to the side of the bed. You are connected to it with glue. We will stay, we'll try to keep the person connected. I had this middle-aged man who was dying, and he wanted to be cured. He was devastated when we had to tell him that a cure is not possible, but we'll keep him comfortable. We were able to make him comfortable. And then nobody else, the family had not asked him. I had asked him, is there something that you would like to do? Any unfinished business? And he said, I want to go back to the primary school where I studied. It was a 2.5 hours drive. The family was poor. Still we persuaded, organized a vehicle for the man to be taken to his primary school on a Sunday so that he could get down at the school, walk with support. He went and saw his classroom, walked around. And on his way back, he told his son, I am at peace now. He did not share everything with us. I still don't know why he felt so connected to his primary school. But there it was. And it is one of the most satisfying things in my life that he got back to the primary school and could be at peace. And this business about connection is something me have been like nomads. I don't feel so connected to anyone who I have lived in so many places. That's okay too. That may not be the kind of connection. The connection may be with open air, maybe with the seaside, anything. We want to make sure that everybody has a chance to speak and offer. I quite realize that this group is a truckload of wisdom and experience, and we want to hear others. Here are the few points that I said, not in way of assessment. Assessment we mentioned about the values and belief system. We did not talk about a lot about God, did we? I talked about connection, nature, primary school, Of course, a lot of people are connected by faith and religion, and any wish like that needs to be satisfied. And some intensive care units actually prevents priests from going in to give a last communion to a Catholic patient. And that's a horrendous injustice, which cannot be tolerated. So we talked about the assessment, talked about the connections, etc. And here is a summary of what I think is most important. Get to know the person. Acknowledge the positives. What has been a tremendous achievement of that person in his or her life. Convey that you care. Make the person feel loved and cared for. Find out what is most meaningful for the person in that life. Try to find a purpose in the person's life. Even if it is the last 3 days, maybe there is something that we can offer them. You have been in pain. We'll keep you free of pain. If there is something that they want to do, that will be reinforced. And for an example, in the last few days, the woman was crying, "I wish I could see my grandchild who was 6 months away from coming. I will never be able to see my grandchild." We actually got the person to make a recording of a message to the child. That was, even in those last days, that was giving a meaning to her life and a purpose. Restore connections or build new connections. And there, it particularly becomes important, building connections is with love. I will end with this quick story. This girl was a visitor from USA. Except for the COVID season, every year in the month of December, some 12 to 15 students will land in our place from Iowa University. It has been something going on for 8 years. They'll spend 3 weeks with us. They're all undergraduate students. This girl was a particularly introvert. They had come to our inpatient unit. Everybody was getting engaged, talking to somebody, getting engaged. This girl would sit alone in a corner and look at a book or write something. She was not interacting with others. This woman, this picture was taken 1 week before this woman died. Woman with advanced cancer of the lung. If she couldn't breathe much, she just about managed to get enough air to sustain herself. She was there in the bed all alone. She had a paid caregiver because there were no family members. She sat there and called the girl with a gesture. This girl went across. She couldn't speak a word of Malayalam and she couldn't speak a word of English. But they connected. They became great friends. And in the loneliness caused by introversion, this girl was lonely. This woman was sensitive enough. Maybe she was so lonely that she could identify somebody else's loneliness. And she, I think, gave spiritual care to this girl. She died within a week and this girl was devastated. But that connection is my example of building a new connection with a little bit of love, care, and affection. I now will come back to the facilitator to read out any important chat questions. Or if somebody would like to speak, please speak. I would like to start with anybody who has not spoken so far.
Sir, I think we've covered most of the important points that were in the chat box. There were just other few points which were comments. So I think we'll move on to the
interaction.
Interactions.
Thank you.
Good evening, Dr. Raj.
Hi.
I hope you're doing well. Stella here.
Hi, Stella. Hello.
I hope you're doing well.
I am doing well. Thank you very much. I didn't know you were here.
Yeah, I don't miss most of the sessions, which are very valuable to us. So thank you today that I was able to get into your session as well. But thank you for this lovely talk today, which you gave us. There was a lot of things on the connections which you were telling, which we with our children also go through, which I would love to share. And as you said rightly, most of the time, we actually see the children connecting more to a person who is staying away. Even if our counselors or our social workers are there, sometimes the social worker doesn't feel apt inadequate. She feels to go to the child. But we've noticed from somewhere there will be some child who will just run suddenly to that person and catch hold of her hand and say, Akka, ulla vanga, you know. It is so touching to see that connection. And then suddenly the girl who was feeling shy and was not feeling up to it to meet the child or to sit with the child, after a few sessions, we suddenly see there's so much of a connect. And then you see the family also joining in, because the child not only talks to the person, it goes and brings her mother or father and introduces her to the social worker, you know, and that's where our connect starts. And that it is so beautiful to see that, you know. So it was very touching when you brought this story. So I just thought, let me tell you about what we two go through in us. So thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Stella. Stella, golden butterflies. What a golden experience that you shared. your show ended with that picture of the American girl and one of her patients. So Stella is giving how, in that I said that it was the patient who was actually giving more spiritual care to that person. And children do such a lot. They have so much more of God in them than us, I often feel.
Absolutely.
And that is absolutely true. But the reverse is also so important. We all love children, but we are scared of interacting with them emotionally. We are mortally scared. There is this.
I would like to add.
Yeah, yes, please.
Wonderful session, sir. Thank you so much. I went to Manipal Hospital. I remember last year I met a person who was a farmer, and he had come for some pain medication in cancer ward. So I asked him how he is doing and all, and his son told, and they explained he was being taken care very well. And then I said, I'm very young, sir. I don't have much to say, but would you like to talk something? Would you like to share something? He was in his late 70s. And then he said, in Kannada, he said, madam, have you ever visited a market, soul sante kind of thing, which is very bright in the morning? How is it in the evening? There's nothing. And, you know, it really touched me. Like, you know, in a just one sentence, he said so much that life is sometimes full of everything. And life, when you see, there's nothing. I mean, sometimes I used to feel that I learned so much from him. And that's the reason I go and joining this session was mainly Pallium India to learn more. And I get a lot of gratitude. I mean, I was feeling that something is missing in me. So that's how I started. I started my counseling. And then I work with Indian Cancer Society. I get immense pleasure. I'm not saying I'm not happy, but something in me was missing. And since I started working there, now I know what I want in my life. The gratitude, I get a lot of pleasure from it. So it's so much.
Purnima, thank you very much. Oh, I am going to cherish that story.
Yeah.
What a great man. And such a powerful message in one sentence. Thank you for sharing that. Anybody wants to comment on that or on any other matter? I have a little bit of a technological challenge right at the moment. My screen has gone blank for a reason that I do not understand. So I'm glad I can still hear you and you can hear me. We'll continue to converse. But facilitator, please note that I no longer can see people. So you will have to be my eyes also.
Dr. Raj, thank you so much. This is Vandana.
Hi, Vandana.
If nobody wants to share anything, may I, with your permission, share?
Please, Vandana, please do.
So, Dr. Raj, I've been interacting with a 28-year-old patient, stage 4 lung carcinoma. And the first time I met with him was at the OPD. And the doctors, like you would know, they told him you have stage 4 cancer. And that was it. He was in denial. He's a non-smoker. And his first reaction was, why me? He got into a conversation with the doctor and the doctor wasn't able to kind of manage him. So he was sent to me and it's been a year and a half. We are in connection. We stay connected. He speaks to me. He's been given, as per medicine, he's on oral chemo and he's been given 6 years. He's now 29 years of age. And he calls me his second mother. Dr. Raj, he sends me messages every day, more than often. Hello, Ma, how are you? I was admitted for COVID. He started crying, Dr. Raj, saying, if something were to happen to you, what will happen to me? And yesterday only, I had a conversation with him for an hour where we spoke about how he does his namaz, how often he talks to his mother. And then he tells me, you know, Ma, I've never thought about my cancer. The doctors have told me that you're going to live for, when I met the doctor, they said you're going to live for 6 months. If I hadn't met you, probably I would have been languishing somewhere. But today here I am accepting life as it comes. We spoke about death. We spoke about how uncertain everybody's life is. Nobody can predict when somebody is going to die. And that's how my connection is with him, Dr. Raj. I also know at some point the disease is going to progress. I'm aware of that. He is also aware of that. And we speak about everything. He speaks about his job, how he feels low. He doesn't know how to handle his emotions sometimes. So he was to come to Mumbai for a follow-up. And because of COVID, his oncologist has told him to postpone it. So, that conversation keeps happening about the uncertainty, but also about how grateful, in fact, both of us are to have each other in our lives. So that's what connection, that is what I wanted to share with you and with everyone, Dr. Raj, that how beautifully you've said that it's about connections. We've just got to be there for them. And they need to know that, yes, they're not alone and there's somebody who understands them as a human being who goes through all the emotions, which sometimes doctors tend to overlook, I would say, because when a diagnosis is given and when they go back for a follow-up, they don't even give 2 minutes or 5 minutes to the patient. You are stable, you go back, we'll see you after 3 months. So I think that at that moment, it's very important for someone to be there, to be hand-holding them and just be there for them. So yeah, that's what I wanted to share, Dr. Raj. Thank you.
Vandana, on behalf of everybody, thank you for sharing that experience. We doctors sometimes think that we are the most important cogs in the wheel of healthcare, but little do we know. Very clearly, you are the most important person in the healthcare team for him. You made the most difference. And he gave you back quite a lot, I see. That is the way it works out. Sometimes you are not sure whether you gave more or got back more in return. Thank you. This story also brings out, one thing that you mentioned, Vandana, that they give only 2 or 5 minutes. This is something that oncologists and many of us doctors talk about. we have to see so many patients. Like Chrismuth in his article was saying, in his country, a doctor, an oncologist would see 15 patients a day. And here an oncologist sees 80 patients a day. They are also human beings. There are limits to what they can give. But it is more than time. I have forgotten whose quotation it is. Well, it's somebody whom I know very well, but right now I can't remember the name. He wrote, "The way care is given can reach the most hidden places. The way care is given can reach the most hidden places." The way you look at somebody, the way you touch somebody, and even if you are spending only a minute, the way it is done, it wouldn't be as good as what Vandana has achieved, but it's still valuable. And the one thing that I would share with the busy doctors is this quote: if you have only a minute, you have to fill in so much of humanity, care, and love into that minute.
Thank you, Dr. Raj, for saying that. I think 2 minutes with love and attention can achieve so much for the patient.
I am guilty. This is the last 2 minutes that I have not talked about religion. I have not talked about God. I would say one thing about faith and religion. They are very important. For the majority of human beings in India, they are frightfully important. And that is something that is part of what we should restore. One thing that I would proclaim from the rooftops is never try to push God down people's throats. When somebody wants to express their spiritual anguish, if you get a religious leader in, that must be somebody who understands human beings and diseases and death and dying. Because by pushing God down their throat and reinforcing guilt, of course you didn't have enough faith. Naturally, this comes to you. Keep praying. And the message is, if you are still suffering, you are not praying hard enough. There is a book called I Will Lie Down in Peace, which is written by Usha Jeshudasan. Jeshudasan, her husband, was a missionary working with cancer patients in Vellore. She was also a missionary working with him. And he died at the age of 40 of a liver disease. And she writes, friends and relatives would come to visit and ask me to pray. When my children and I explain that we are praying all the time, they look at us with disbelief, as if to say, if you were praying hard enough, you would be better. It's all your fault. This is the way that a faith can be used as a weapon and not as a tool. So with that word of caution, I realize that my time is up and I hand this back to the facilitator.
Thank you so much, Dr. Raj, for your time. And I forgot to mention in the beginning, thanks a lot for joining us and spending time with us, even with a very short notice. And thank you, everybody, for being a part of the session. So see you all next week. Thank you. Bye.
Namaste. Have a great evening, everybody. Thank you.